Welcome to another weekly Ask GMBN Tech Q&A clinic. Get your questions into us at the email address on the screen, or you can add them in the comments below. All right, so first up this week is from FREDDIE DEMBREY. Hi FREDDIE. Ask GMBN Tech, can you run SRAM brakes, levers and calipers on Shimano rotors? Thanks. Is the answer to that. Bearing in mind that some disc sizes are slightly different. For example, you get the 200 versus the 203 with the SRAM Shimano thing there. And disc rotors, actually, some of them are a little thinner than others, although your brakes will compensate for that. In case you wanted to know, Shimano rotors are 1.8 mil thick as standard, and obviously they get thinner as they wear. If they start getting beyond, I think it's 1.5, then you want to sack them off because they start losing their strength and their integrity. With SRAM ones, I think it's 1.85, so they're very, very fractionally bigger, and I think formulas are fractionally smaller. But that doesn't really make too much difference. Let's say your pistons will compensate for that. As long as you have the hardware correct where your brake is mounted. So if it's mounted on a direct mount, you might need some of those cone washers to compensate for the 200 or the 203 rotor, depending on which way round your brakes are. And of course, if you've got the correct adapter, always make sure that your brake pads sit completely onto the actual disc rotor braking surface, and make sure the disc rotor can't foul the inside of the caliper as it passes through. And if that's all good, then you're good to go. Okay, nice punchy one from Daylight Sensor IMA. Ask GMBN Tech, is it normal to blow through 160 millimeters of rear travel on a 2 foot drop? I have a 2013 Canyon Strive AL 8.0. No, it's not normal. But that does depend on a lot of things. It depends on how you like your suspension, how you ride, the way you even approach that drop. Let's just talk about the actual drop from physical riding point of view. If you're going off a drop really fast, you can actually meet with the ground a bit and you can actually lessen the impact. Whereas if you're just popping off something, you get all that sort of downforce in one hit. Now, of course, if it's a wheelie drop, you can lower that back wheel. If you just popping off, you have more impact. So it does affect you slightly differently. And of course, your ability as a rider to use your body to absorb that impact. But just the physicality on the bike, it sounds like to me either your rear suspension is slightly too linear for the way that you want to ride, if you want to be doing drops like this, or perhaps it's set up slightly undersprung. So the first thing you want to do is check the spring on your bike, whether it's a coil spring or an air spring, is basically giving you enough or not too much sag. So you're looking between 20 and 30% of the available travel to sag when you sit on the bike. If you've got an air shock, you can measure this with the O-ring on the actual shock shaft. If it's not, if you've got a coil shock, the best way to do that is to measure with you not sat on the bike, the distance between the saddle and the tire, and then by subtracting the amount of suspension travel you have on the bike, you can work out your 20 or 30% sag when you sit on it, and that gap will obviously close. So get that set up, and if it's not correct, then if it's an air shock, then you can adjust the air volume in that shock. Sometimes you can do this with air volume spacers, sometimes it has to be done in different ways internally, but that's basically your solution to that, so hopefully you can get that done. All right, next up is from Herbie. Is there any disadvantage of overspending grease in a headset? I normally put grease between the spacers and between stem and steerer tube. I've just got a new Canyon Spectral AL 6.0, nice bike dude, and I took the forks off just to have a look how it works in it and noticed that there's much less grease than I would put in. Thanks. Bearing in mind that when bikes are put together in big production lines, they put in what's an efficient amount of grease. So cartridge bearings themselves, they will have grease inside them. The whole point of them is they're a contained unit. You pop into the bicycle, you pop into the headset, and it works. The advantage of having more grease in there really is an extra barrier against corrosion and water, and getting water into that bearing in the first place. Of course, any water getting into the actual cartridge bearing, that is where the problems start arising. So the more you can ward that off, the better, really, in my eyes. I would always prefer to have a bit more grease, especially coming from the UK, we have a lot of wet weather. So I tend to put a bit more grease in there when I put stuff together, and then afterwards you can just wipe it down on the outside. And then periodically after, I don't know, 2 or 3 months or however bad your weather may or may not be, have a little inspect, make sure that it's basically still in there. If it's gone the sort of a browny, sludgy color, it's a good idea to wipe it all clean and check the bearings are good, and then replace that. But bearing in mind that Bearings themselves are only good if they're running nice and smooth and have grease in them in the first place. The minute that they are actually all gritty and that, no amount of grease being applied to them is gonna repair them. So just take that into account. So yeah, just treat it as a waterproof barrier. Okay, Franktown wants to know, what is the purpose of a star-fangled nut? You say that with the top cap, it helps align and tighten everything, but I don't get how that works exactly. Okay, so parts of a headset, right? So if you look at the fork itself, you have the steerer tube on there. Then on the steerer tube, you have the lower crown race. So it's on the crown of the fork, you have bottom part of the race that sits into the bearing. The bearing sits into the cup in the frame. The steerer tube passes through that. The upper cup sits on the frame. The steerer tube passes through that. Bearing sits into that. Then you have a selection of washers that sit into that, like a compression ring. Then you have the stem, you have the top cap. On the inside of that steerer tube, you have the star-fangled nut, which is wedged in. It's like a barb, so it can't move. When you adjust or tighten the bolt on the top, it basically pulls the steerer tube up through the stem. That's why you have to leave that gap at the top there. When I say pull this, I'm making quite a big movement. You're actually talking like less than half a millimeter or so when it moves. And the idea is you're pulling everything taut, or you're preloading the bearing. So it's not actually doing anything to the bearing itself. It's just making sure that all the components of the headset are all taut and they're in place against each other, so there is no movement, as in any sort of movement that's not just the physical turning of the headset bearing itself. Because any movement you get, any sort of rattling in there, that with the amount of leverage you have at the wheel end and the handlebar end, is going to start slowly destroying those bearings, which of course can lead to other problems. So it's essentially just a way of preloading the system, making sure everything is nice and tight and doing its job correctly. If you run a bike with a loose headset, or if you try and basically put the system together without having that top cap on there, you will never get it tight and the headset will always be slightly loose. That's all it is. All right, so Sumner Bob is next. Doddy, I've got a Specialized FSR downhill from the 90s. Oh, dude, trick bike. Got a friend who's got one of them in Shrewsbury, actually. He's got a Palmer replica. And the suspension linkage bolts keep loosening after every ride, even though it's been torqued up properly. He uses bushings instead of bearings. Will Loctite fix this? In theory, yes. So Threadlock does a great job of stopping bolts coming undone. However, If the reason they're coming undone is because of movement coming elsewhere and the bolts are starting to unwind rather than rattle loose, then they won't help. They will always unwind, basically, however much you put on. And if that's happening, that would suggest that the bushes are worn. So my advice would be to, with all the bolts tight, check to see if there's any play or any movement in the back end of that bike. You should still be able to track down the relevant bushing kits for it. Get a fresh bushing kit in there if that is the problem. Then when you put it back together, use the relevant greases, assembly compounds, and thread lock, of course, and use your torque wrench on there. Then hopefully you'll have no problems. Basically, it sounds like movement is happening for somewhere, but thread lock on the bolts is your first point of call if everything works, because it's designed to lock those threads and stop it rattling loose. Okay, next up from Kenny Minigun. Are straight pull spokes stroke hubs suitable for abusive riding like downhill and enduro? Are they any better than traditional J-bend spokes and hubs? Yeah, they're absolutely fine, to be honest. It's more down to how they're built and laced up and tensioned, as is the case with any sort of wheel. If you look on screen now, we're just going to look at the J-bend, pros and cons, and we'll do the same for straight pull afterwards. So first up, there's J-bend pros. They're easily available to suit any hub. Basically any sort of standard hub, that is, with a flange and drilled holes. They've always been made this way. They've been made so long that companies make excellent spokes like this. They can be laced in any cross pattern like this as well. You're not sort of confined to having to build hubs in a two cross or whatever pattern. You could build them two cross, you could build them radial, three cross, four cross even, or if you're daft, you could build them in a snowflake pattern if you really wanted to. There is no limits to what you can do with a regular J-bend spoke. Arguably though, they are slower to lace up. So whether that's a good thing or not, that is just one of the facts, just because they take a little bit more time to intricately put them into the hub itself. One of the cons is like they can break at the elbow. And although DT do say that their spokes pretty much versus each other are about as strong as each other, it's basically down to how they're built and the quality of the hub that they're put into that affects this with the J-bend spoke. So for example, if the holes in the hub we put the spoke into are slightly bigger than the actual size of the spoke going through that, that can create a sort of an amount of movement, and of course that could stress the elbow itself and it could crack at the elbow and break. Now also, if the wheels are under tensioned, it enables too much flex, and the flex has to go somewhere in a spoke, and it's going to basically fatigue that elbow, which eventually will break. And of course, there's slightly more material. We're talking a marginal amount here, so you could argue that you got a slightly heavier wheel with J-Bend spokes as well. But if you look at straight pulls, right, so the straight pull chart is on the screen now, the pros are they're slightly shorter spokes, so you can build a slightly lighter wheel. We're talking like a minute amount here, but in some cases, that's a really, really important thing. Arguably, they're easier to lace as well because you just drop them straight into the hub. So that's a great thing too. And they can arguably be stronger as well because they don't have a bend. So this isn't really a physical problem of the spoke, it's more the fact that you can drop the spoke into a hub and it's going to be as strong as it can be because it can only do a certain job in a certain way. It's not subject to the quality control of a hub or the way it's built to sacrifice the strength of that. The cons are you have different straight pull spokes for different hubs. They're not all the same. There are some standardized versions, but Mavic have their own slightly thin ones at the head. They also have some slightly thicker ones, and different brands do that as well. So it's not a standardized item like a J-Bend spoke, which you can get literally in any bike shop. The advantage again of a J-Bend is you could buy one for a 29 inch wheel and you can have it cut down and re-threaded and it will fit a 27.5 or a 26 or anything. Really convenient if you're doing any sort of traveling or globetrotting to have J-Bends for that sort of reason. Another con is that they can only be laced in the orientation that the hub allows. So if you've got a straight pull hub and it's set up for two cross, you can only ever lace your hub wheels up two cross. You're not going to be able to take advantage of having a three cross design, for example. It simply will not allow that. And also, if not tensioned correctly, this is very rare and this used to happen on older designs, the head of the spokes can actually become unhooked, which I think is probably one of your concerns. But let's not forget that a wheel works on even tension. It's not pushing, it's a pulling thing that basically enables a wheel to be strong and tensioned. So really, they'll be absolutely fine for you, and hopefully you've just seen a little bit of detail, pros and cons for both styles. For the record, I think straight pulls look way cooler on a bike. They look so futuristic and purposeful, but I think I prefer traditional J-Bends for all of the obvious reasons. So there we go, there's another weekly GMBN Tech Clinic in the bag. If you've got any questions, let us know in those comments, or you can just email them direct to us. For a couple more cool videos, if you want to learn how to fix a chain when you're out on a trail in the rain, check this video out with Jess down here. That's fixing your chain three ways there. That's really cool. And if you want to win some insane synchros wheels, super, super ridiculously light ones, click down here. All good stuff there. As always, give us a like, give us a share, subscribe to the channel.